Hello everybody, I am NicoD. I am back with a new single board computer. It's the NanoPi M4. It's a small brother of the NanoPC T4. So it's got the same SoC, the ROC 3399. It's a 6-core CPU with 2 big cores of 2 GHz and 4 small cores of 1.5 GHz. This gives a lot of heat, so it's got a really big heatsink. I've put a fan underneath it, and also I put 4 screws into it, so I can raise it on top of my table. This board is really, really very fast. I didn't expect it to be so fast. I've got a lot of 8-core SBCs and I thought it would be no match, but it truly is. I've got it for about 2 weeks now. I've done a lot of tests. I've tried all the available operating systems for it. And I must say, I'm very impressed by this board. I love it. I truly love it. I will show you all the operating systems I've tried. I will do some benchmarks with it. And I will compare it with my other single board computers. So let's go! On the other side of the board, we've got the ROC chip RK 3399 SoC. So it's got 2 big cores, Cortex A72 at 2 GHz, and 4 small cores, Cortex A53 at 1.5 GHz. The GPU is a Mali T864. Now the upside of the board, I'll start at the right and go clockwise. So first we see 4 USB 3 ports. This is great to have. The debug UART is in between of those ports. Then you see the RTC connector for the battery. It's got gigabit Ethernet. Then we see the audio connection. It's a 3.5mm audio jack. Then the eMMC sockets. This is also great to have. HDMI is 2.0. It's powered with USB Type-C. This is also good, a lot better than micro USB. Then we see the Bluetooth and Wi-Fi chip. So this is a dual band at 2.4 GHz and at 5 GHz. Then the connectors for the antennas. Then there are the MIPI connectors. So the first one is CSI and DSI together. So you can either connect a camera on it or connect a display on it. And the second is only CSI, so only for a camera. You can connect 2 cameras at once on this board. And the 2 LEDs are next. Then we see the GPIO pins, so it's got a 40-row GPIO, almost the same as the Raspberry Pi, but it's not completely compatible. And we also have got a 20-pin GPIO, this is a special one. There is a USB 2.0 on there, and also a PCIe x2 that you can connect over there. To download the operating system, I type in NanoPi M4 downloads. The second one is from a friendly ARM itself. So then we go to download link. Download link here. Okay, we choose Google Drive. So here are all the operating systems they have prepared. There is the Xenial armhf. This is a 32-bit operating system. Then we've got the Bionic arm64. This is a 64-bit operating system. And then the Friendly Core. This is without the desktop. And you also can download Android over here. Here we are in Lubuntu 32-bit. So this is Lubuntu Xenial, so 16.04, not 18.04. There were some problems when doing an upgrade. The locals aren't set right. I explain how to fix this in the description. Also, ZRAM didn't work. I also explain how to fix this in the description. The repositories were outdated here. To watch videos, install VLC. This works very well. Firefox does not work in the Lubuntu 32-bit. Chromium works, but YouTube playback is very poor, only in 480p. For that, we can use Vivaldi browser. So to download Vivaldi, we go to Google and we type in Vivaldi browser download ARM. This works on every ARM SBC, so if you have got bad YouTube playback, install Vivaldi browser and it will be better. The file we have downloaded is a .deb file, so to install this I will use gdebi package installer. So open, then search for the file, then install package. After that you have to do sudo apt-get update and sudo apt-get upgrades. Here we are in Lubuntu 64 bits. Both Lubuntus are clocked at 1.8 for the big cores and 1.4 for the small cores. This Lubuntu works very well. There's just one problem with host APD when you upgrade. I couldn't fix it, but everything works. You can still install programs and everything works like it is. Firefox works well here. It isn't as stable as Chromium to serve, it sometimes crashes. But the YouTube playback is very good here, and 1080p it's perfect, so this is great.
You know, we've been doing this, the two of us, and Astrid. Say hello, Astrid.
Hello.
Well, more or less in our spare time.
Their time to Sparty with editing. This means that Sparty can...
Also for playing video files, Firefox works really great. It works better than VLC and a Qt5 player.
You think he's coming back?
You don't owe these people.
There is one problem I found with this Lubuntu 64-bit. Almost none of the Linux games work here. At last there is Armbian Bionic and Armbian Stretch. Both work very well. Both are clocked at 2 GHz for the big cores and 1.5 for the small cores. This has got its advantages, it's a lot faster, but it has got its disadvantages, and that's the temperature. So that's the next thing we're gonna look at. So in Armbian, with my 5-volt fan and with the screws to raise it, the idle temperature is 32 degrees, and with the fan and maxed out is 65 degrees Celsius. Without the fan, the idle temperature is 40 degrees Celsius, and maxed out it throttles at 85 degrees Celsius. This after 14 minutes and 30 seconds, so it takes a long time before it reaches 85 degrees Celsius, but if you want to use this board at max in Armbian, then use a fan for it. The Lubuntu temperatures are a lot lower than in Armbian, so with the fan in idle it is 29 degrees Celsius and maxed out it goes to 54 degrees Celsius. And without a fan it's 42 degrees in idle and maxed out it is 69 degrees Celsius. This after 30 minutes, so this is probably why they underclocked it to 1.8 GHz and 1.4 GHz. But we'll see in the benchmarks that this is at a cost. In Armbian, the BMW Blender benchmark in 1080p was 1 hour 13 minutes and 50 seconds. So compared to the Lubuntu 64-bit, which was 1 hour 28 minutes and 13 seconds, this was 15 minutes slower than the Armbian. This because of the lower clock speeds. And the Lubuntu 32-bit was 2 hours 20 minutes and 51 seconds. But Blender does very bad with 32-bit systems, so this will not be the same result with every program. Compared with my other single board computers, only the Odroid XU4 is a little bit faster, 1 minute, and the NanoPi T3 Plus is 4 minutes faster. So it can compete very well with the other single board computers, even the octa-cores. The power consumption in Lubuntu is 0.3 amps without a load, and a max load is 1.5 amps. In Armbian it's also 0.3 amps without a load, and the max load is 2 amps. So it's a half amp difference. This is what the performance costs. Then the transfer speeds. With an SD card it's not that fast, so it's like a Raspberry Pi. It's actually around 15 megabytes a second if you want to copy something. An eMMC is a lot faster to read. It's above 100 megabytes a second. And then a SSD via USB 3 is 389 megabytes a second read, and the write is also above 300 megabytes a second. So the USB 3 is really great. So if we combine that with the gigabit Ethernet, which is 97 megabytes per second, so you can completely fill those 97 megabytes a second with the USB 3, and the Wi-Fi is also pretty fast. So my conclusion, This is an awesome SBC. This is really the next generation SBC. It's great, it's at 5 volts. I can power it with my power banks. It's great, it's in the Raspberry Pi form factor. All the other RK3399 boards are a lot bigger and they are powered with a lot more voltage, I think 19 volts. It is a lot faster than all the other quad-core single board computers. There's not one that can compete with it. There are also a lot of RK3399 boards, so the software support for it is really good. I would advise to buy the 4GB model and you will be good for a lot of years with this board. Maverick from Odroid will be making a new GameStation Turbo for the RK3399, so then the games will be really great. I am waiting for that. It's great that you can watch YouTube in 1080p without a problem with it. It's also very stable. I haven't had one crash with it, so that's a really great thing. This is the first SBC that I have that really could replace my desktop PC. It's not as fast as my desktop PC, but you can do everything that you need to do, and it's stable. With the heatsink, a 5 volts power adapter and a USB Type-C cable, it costs $83.97, which is exactly the same as the Tinkerboard S, so it doesn't cost that much for what it is. I will make a few more videos about this board, one about video editing on SBCs and one about gaming on this board. This board does really great as a video editor. It's the fastest of all my SBCs. I didn't want to show the scores right now because I will show them in my later video. Thank you all for watching. Please like my video and subscribe to my channel. See you later. Bye.